Of course, an airline is the symbol of balance. It starts from ICAR's dream of flying, and then we developed an engineering concept that made us fly. It is important to think of balance as the vision behind any project and consider realistic aspects and the main arguments put forward by the main actors involved in this process. And there will be a last speaker for now. We have already entered the Q&A time, but I think it was interesting to follow the speaker's point of view. And now allow me to give the floor to Mr. Andrei Cârstea, Operational Control Center Manager from TAROM. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It is an honor to be here with you today. I will try to be concise, given that the issues of legality have already been tackled. So I will try to mention a few things from the perspective of air operation. TAROM has been working in passenger air transport for the last 60 years. We are interested in promoting solutions to improve passenger services and preserve at least the level of safety we have now, also hand in hand with reducing costs. In this respect, we appreciate that changing the ATMs is a good thing and will have a positive influence on reducing costs. Also, changing the structure of traffic management by using air routes, by not using indirect air routes but direct air routes, now can be good. We know that the success of flight lies in planning, because now we have constraints linked to inefficiency in air navigation. We often fly on routes that are not the shortest between two points, which forces us to take more fuel, that creates additional fuel consumption of the aircraft, and this also means increasing the CO2 emissions or GHG emissions. Also, indirect routes will increase the flight time. The consequence is that there will be unjustified crowding of the airspace and the limiting of slots, creating shorter or longer delays of flights. That is reflected also in the airport capabilities. And sometimes there will be higher pressure on the landing and taking off operations. As the member of the parliament said, we have to focus on passengers because they pay the ticket. The benefits of SES with direct flights between two destinations, with direct routes between two destinations, will solve many of the problems. Another positive aspect is the removal of national barriers that will decrease cost and time. Also, shorter routes will increase performance of the aircrafts. They will be able to reach more remote destinations. So, with respect of the companies, we will have now the possibility of better planning routes. We appreciate that direct routes airspace and the definition of entry and exit points is the best solution we have for now. As a conclusion, the beneficiaries will be passengers who will pay less operation costs. So they will pay less for tickets, they will get to the destination in a shorter time, and there will be other opportunities for them to have connecting flights. There will be lower cost for air navigation systems, lower cost for fuel, and the environment will benefit too from less pollution generated by shorter routes and shorter time in the air. So much from me as a representative of an airlines company. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Kirsta. And I open the floor for questions and answers. We have a first question already from our online viewers. We will answer this question after a short intervention in guise of conclusion from Mr. Marinescu, and then I will read out a question that was asked online. Of course, you have the chance to ask your questions to those of you present here. Thank you. Thank you for all your contributions, for your interventions. Of course, I must say I met all the stakeholders in this industry, all those who are influenced somehow by this new regulation. I met the presidents of the providers, of the service providers, similar to what we have here with ROMATSA, Bulatsa, Belgacom, all the providers. So we met absolutely everyone, EASA, Eurocontrol, everyone was there. Let me add just a few things. FABs, FABs, I don't like them, but reality proves I'm right. In 5 years' time, of course, it's very good with the night routes. It is something very common between service providers, between France and Italy. Companies say, why don't you take my sector and I use yours? So there is this swap of sectors. Now, this, of course, borders on our discussions of sovereignty and borders. The same happens with Austria. There is a small piece of Austrian air that overlaps Germany. They don't even talk about it anymore. This goes without saying. It's a tacit, silent agreement. The fact that Turkey asks for two entries, serves my point of view, because this is what zigzag flying is about. They allow you to enter an airspace through a specific interval or space. So FABs, to my mind, are useless. So right now, we have air traffic control centers that stop their activities at the border, though it may be possible to go beyond the physical border. And if we create those FABs, what will happen? Of course, the same thing will happen. Some centers will be able to do some control activities beyond the limits of the FAB, but some won't. So why not completely reshape airspace? Perhaps some countries will have no more center. That is possible. We don't know yet. But let's see. There won't be any civilian center. Let's forget about military control, air traffic control. That will always be national activity. But think of a small country that an airplane takes just the blink of a second or a very short time to pass. Well, we don't know whether FABs are necessary. Returning to CESAR, the unit cost. The performance scheme should not be 3% all over. Some have 37, some have 74. So the performance scheme should be connected to actual results from each of the service providers. And it should be linked to the reduction capacity. Otherwise, it's impossible to have one solution fits all. the free market for support services. I refused that idea from the very beginning of mandatory separation. Technically speaking, it is very difficult to separate communication from navigation and give someone everything, wires, equipment, everything that comes with it. Though some service providers at the level of the nation did that of their own accord. So it is possible to go the other way also. But I think it's very difficult. But I introduced in my proposal something like that. Why not try where it is possible, technically possible, to see a better offer in terms of quality and price, and show in the national plan, in the performance scheme, that they did such a thing. Show the performance review body that it was the best alternative. The council says the same. The member state may, so they use the same word may as a possibility. So we have a common position here. It may accept some services or award some services to another provider, but this is not mandatory. The weather services. I can't tell you whether this is true or not, but some representatives from France, they said that 75% of the 70% of the information from civil aviation revenue comes from weather information. And why should passengers pay anything from the national weather service? It should be paid from the state budget, not from the money of the passengers. This is an important service, the weather forecast service, for anything else, for other types of disasters. For why should passengers pay for that? This is not free market. This is, let's be fair to the passengers. 552 is not linked to SES. Perhaps we can talk later. You said that 552 is not reflected now. I believe it is. I checked that myself. Perhaps I am missing some parts. Perhaps there are some things that were not properly reflected there. You also said something that the national authority should go through an accreditation process. You know, do you know what the situation is now, and it may be more severe in the future? CESAR equipment, and this is the future. There's nothing we can do. We can't prevent the future from happening. They couldn't do it in the Second World War. They couldn't prevent the Industrial Revolution in the UK 100 and something years ago. So we can't fund CESAR. We can't fight it. But if we buy and deliver the equipment now, and I will go back to CESAR, and this equipment is distributed in several member states, they need certification of the equipment in every member state. Is that normal to your mind? Is this normal? So if I supposedly want to use a propeller, Herzl, let's say, one which is very familiar, one that has never been used in Romania before, it should be certified in Romania, though the propeller is used in France and Germany, in other places. Why shouldn't there be a mutual recognition mechanism?
You say that this national authority should be accredited. Then why not give them the salaries that they receive in Brussels? They should have the same salary all over Europe, like the FAA, right? You know, whenever such an authority is set up, we always have three directors, five sub-directors, and it's actually the ministry who dictates. Mr. Brenner proposed that Europe control should be the central level in order to ensure uniformity. But I think that the services should be provided by the service providers, whether they are two, three, or four who come together and provide a centralized service, that would be okay. I think that the PRB should be independent, the network manager also independent, and then Eurocontrol might be doing consultancy. I don't know. This is the problem. I already talked about the fabs. You said that some 9,400 jobs will be lost. But where did you get this figure? I don't think we have a detailed analysis yet. Now, jobs will be lost naturally because right now in Maastricht they have a control center that no longer uses paper, whereas in France they do it completely different. I've never seen how they do control in Romania. I visited France, Belgium, and the Netherlands. I haven't yet visited the Romanian center. But in France, the center is bigger than in Maastricht. I'm an aviation guy, so I know these things. The French center is huge. They will have to introduce the new technology, and some jobs will be lost. Of course, it's natural. And we're not talking about safety. Safety is a different matter altogether. I've already touched upon the unbundling. You said that you agree with the idea of fabs, but you don't agree with the idea of a single service provider. So then why do we need a fab? What's the purpose? If we have 15 service providers in a fab that brings five together, I mean, what's the idea? How do we ensure interoperability between two control centers, such as Romania and Bulgaria? I think there are some things that are not okay. 30 billion, yes, you're right, that's the figure. Companies should be involved in the investment plans. I don't agree, because the service provider has to do other kinds of investment as well. Yes, the airline has to look at the investment plan, but only when there is a need for coordination between the ground and the air, because we want to avoid the cases when we adopt new technological systems that we use in the air, but they are not compatible with the ground equipment. So this is how I see things. Yes, and I do have a sanctioning mechanism, but I also have incentives in mind. I have bonuses to reward people. Now, Cesar. Nobody talks about Cesar. Nobody talked here about Cesar. Cesar doesn't even exist. Forgive me, but Cesar is the most important thing for us, as the IATA representative said. We've invested a lot of money in CESAR. The European Union has invested a lot in this new technology. We cannot fight it. CESAR has to be implemented, and we've already started implementation. We have a deployment manager already, and we have a chapter on the deployment manager in the Parliament text. Unfortunately, the Council does not have any provisions on the deployment manager. But CESAR needs it. The new technology needs a new configuration. The new CESAR technology almost eliminates the routes. We have free route. You take the aircraft from point A and you take it to point B. So it's a free route. We know that the centers, the control centers are being modernized. Well, that's fine. But is this in accordance with the ATM master plan? Are they compliant with CESAR? Because otherwise, we are wasting this money. We are spending money. We're actually throwing it out the window. And with all due respect, and in all responsibility, I believe that this regulation is actually a topic for debate between the industry and the administration. Some member states want to keep the current administration, others may be willing to make concessions, but most countries want to keep the administration as it is, with civil servants, with salaries, with benefits, whereas the industry wants progress. And unfortunately, the progress is impeded by the administrative system. This is the situation in 2015 in the EU, unfortunately. Even though the aviation is really up there, is very advanced, if we compare it to the railway system, for instance, the railways are so behind that they even have to change cars, they have to change gauge and the voltage, the power supply when they cross a national border. Whereas air transport is more advanced, but we still need to help it go even farther. We need to invest in airports. Look at the Emirates, look at Asia. The governments grant huge subsidies to their airlines. We cannot do that. We have to develop regional transports and ensure greater connectivity to help the economy, and this is where we need to work. Thank you, Mr. Marinescu. As I promised, I will now give the floor to our guests here in the room. So the people in the audience, if you have any questions, please do so. We have microphones ready for you. Just introduce yourself and tell us who you would like to ask a question. Hello, I am from the National Trade Union of Tarom, and I have a question, or several questions, for Mr. Marinescu. Well, first of all, I want to know what you intend to do with the money that you will gather from the flying over. I am a European citizen, and I believe that the money that will be gained from the new system should be distributed equally. Second question, why don't you have a staff scheme for jobs which require high qualifications? Because if 9,000 jobs will be lost, this will of course affect the national budget, taxes will be lost, revenue will be lost. And another question, it would be wonderful if we were paid the same as my colleagues in France or in, I don't know, somewhere else in Europe. And I think we should invest more in the air industry, in aircraft factories. Of course, we don't actually manufacture aircraft here, but we can bring Airbuses to Romania and repair them and, you know, service them. So what was your first question? The first question was about the distribution of the money which will be collected from flyovers. As a Romanian citizen, I would like to collect the same amount of money, and I would like the money to be distributed evenly to the number of European citizens. Yes, we're willing to let go of the border, but we are Romanian and European citizens. We are 19 million Romanians. I think we should all get a bit of this money. The French are 30 million. So the money should be distributed evenly. There is a very detailed scheme, and I think the director Stanciu knows better because they have accurate calculations. It's not an amount that is distributed to the number of inhabitants, actually. There is another criterion. I think it's distributed depending on the costs that each service provider has to bear. And aviation has a specificity. You know that in 2015, ROMATSA can ask Air France an extra charge as compared to the year 2013. So this is just 2 years behind. ROMATSA can simply say, sorry, you know, we have less traffic now, and we've redone our calculation, and we have to charge you more. I don't think this can happen in any other industry. In 2 years' time, I could be paying more than what I'm paying now. Right, but I'm asking about the countries that will lose their air traffic control centers. If we lose the center, how will the money be collected by that member state? I think the money should reach us in one way or another. Because if a guy from Rimini, from the air traffic control there, is not paying attention, then the aircraft might actually fall down and cause crash. Well, actually, I think your question includes two things that I've been struggling with for 6 years. What happens if an aircraft crashes in another member state? Well, let's see what the Maastricht people do. They have a regulation, which is two or three pages long, and they have a procedure for this. Let's say we have an accident in Bratislava. This aircraft is actually taken over by Bratislava, but the plane crashes in the Czech Republic, right? Because the two of them are close. We have legal regulations in place. That's not a problem. We can come up with the legal regulation for this purpose. But for the jobs, I think we need an actual detailed assessment. I don't think any country can estimate accurately the number of jobs at this moment. With the current technology, you can you need actually more staff, and if you look at other centers that are more efficient, of course you'll notice that some jobs will be lost. It's possible, but we cannot fight the technological progress. I agree that we need to ensure social protection for people, and member states will probably have to compensate people who will lose their job. I agree, but this doesn't mean that because of this we should resist the technological progress. Let's allow progress to happen and then compensate for it. You, State Secretary, are now in the government. Maybe you have a different point of view than mine. But yes, dear sir, I agree. I worked at the Craiova aircraft factory. And here we have a state secretary who worked for ROMATSA. Do you think he will ever criticize ROMATSA? Never. Never. The question from the room cannot be interpreted because we do not understand properly. But we have experts, we have many specialists. I am an engineer expert. I work in production and in the design, of course, for the military side. But I do have the experience. I think we can build our industry or rebuild the industry, because unfortunately we neglected it. Before beginning the conference, I was talking to the director of the institute, and we were talking about the product that we could launch on the foreign market, but unfortunately there is no willingness. But we have Romaero, we have Baco, and this is on a free market. Remember that Baco is privatized. And what do? They provide repair services. They can even repair the latest generation models. So they can repair aircraft in Baku. Even in Craiova, there is a small private operator that brings aircraft in for repairs. So this can be done, but we have to understand that the aviation industry has an impact on other industries as well. For instance, an export of military pieces, military parts, can only be done if there is a political will. Do you know where the Craiova workers are at? Because I met two of them some days ago, and they actually worked in Italy, in Airbus. They work in Israel. They went all over the world. They're well trained. Unfortunately, they cannot work in Romania because we cannot give them jobs. Thank you very much. I'm sure that you can keep talking to Mr. Marinescu after this is over. You can talk to him informally. Now we'll take more questions from the audience. I am Commander Gabriel Raducanu. I am director of the National Military Aeronautical Authority. I'm insisting on my title because I think we should also be involved in this debate. We are the equivalent of the Civil Aeronautical Authority. I'd like to thank Mr. Marinescu for his very professional speech, but I'd like to add a few things to what you said. You said that the European single sky is meant to be an efficient space, and you said that the main benefits are for the passengers. But I'd like to add one thing that should not be forgotten. The European space is a single space, and we all have to use it. And when I say all, I mean both the civilian and the military bodies. We all have our own set of performance objectives. Of course, the purpose should be the same. The goal should be to be efficient and to bring benefits to passengers. But let's not forget about the safety. Safety means controls and understanding how CES and CESAR can work for Europe. But I think you've forgotten one thing. When we speak about control, we have to speak about responsibility. And the responsibility lies with the Ministry of National Defense and their authority. Safety can only work with both the civilian and the military dimensions. And in Romania, well, actually, Romania is kept in high regard by its European counterparts because our military services work quite well. I'm proud of this. And I assure you that my authority is very open to all the things brought by CESAR. We are a part of the Single Sky Committee. We have a national representative with voting rights there. And I know that the European Commission talks about the implications of this program, but we should also talk about the benefits. I know that last week They said that the master plan for ATM should be updated in order to take into account the military matters as well. We will have to coordinate with NATO and material control, so there will be a troika. Maybe Mr. Panescu will confirm this or not, but we will have an integrated air code. The civilian and military bodies will have to have a common language. The State Secretary knows that we signed some documents in Bulgaria last year. We also signed military documents and we have full openness. You said that we need controls and we need auditing. Mr. Filipoiu can confirm that we are together with you, we support you, even if we do have some observations. But you should know that the Ministry of National Defense and the Joint Staff has plans and analysis for CSAR in all its components. And you know that the data link was postponed by 5 years until 2018. We know that we need resources, cooperation and involvement from everybody, and we are together with you in this.
Thank you. You're right, flexibility in using the airspace. I gave the example of France and Germany, North and South. Indeed, there is this element you mentioned, and steps were made starting 2006, 2007. The military was part of Eurocontrol and was in Eurocontrol, and the discussions was very good. As for data link, it moved further. When I speak, I should bring examples from the specific country. I'm sorry, I couldn't bring examples from Romania. I'm sorry, the mic is off again. We can, if the general is showed this openness, we can meet again among experts, bring the regulation, put it on the table with the two columns or third columns, Commission, Parliament, the Council, and we spend the day together and work together on this concrete document and see what the position of each of the stakeholders is. Mr. Tita, please, you have the floor. I wanted to inform the Honorable Member of the Parliament that in Romania too, in the northern part, in Maramureș, there is a factory working for Boeing. They do spare parts. And in Romania too, that means we are making steps, perhaps small steps, but we still make some. I didn't say anything to contradict you. In Arad, there are some things done, helicopters, and also in Brasov, but we should do more. Okay, then we should point out that we do some things regarding ROMATSA. Indeed, I come from ROMATSA and my heart goes to ROMATSA. I don't think it's a bad thing that someone coming from a company gains some political function in the ministry. We do agree with SES on principle and we support you, but we must think about the people working there. We must talk to them too and explain to them, listen, in 5 or 6 years the future will look different. We can't decide upon their future without consultations with them. We should consult people from ROMATSA. They are highly trained people and their skill was recognized throughout Europe. Indeed, I visited ROMATSA 2, 3, 4, 5 years ago. But there is a point where we start this discussion. We started it in 2004, and we're 10 years later, and nothing happened. This is a natural development, I should say. Sometimes ROMATSA was not present because it was not invited. Thank you for this vivid dialogue. 3-4 other questions, perhaps. I am Radu Melica, Aircraft Associations. Technological progress leads to fewer staff. It doesn't matter whether we agree or not. This is the course of progress. In other countries, ASFE management companies are a sort of political tools where, you know, people representing political parties are hired. And in such countries, it is very difficult for political decision makers to agree to lose their budget, their jobs. And Mr. Marinescu is aware of that. This does not happen here in Romania because perhaps our word does not count so much. So the question coming, what will happen with the terminal areas or units? The fee is not high, neither low, but this terminal charge or charge per terminal matters to us. In Germany, there was a reduction of tax per airport terminal. I don't know whether in Romania that will still be the monopoly of ROMATSA. I am Virgil Dinu, and I represent the Professional Association of Traffic Controllers in Romania. I do have a certain expertise with regard to SES. During the 7-8 years, I participated in several meetings organized by the European Commission, and I was involved in several initiatives, say FABA or SIST Europe. Functional ASP block was a failure, was an exclusive initiative of the Commission that led to nowhere. From what you said, I can extract some conclusions. I heard 50 times about money and cost, and only 5 or 6 times about safety. Forgive me, but I can't help noticing it. It is my profession, after all. As for the various things said about poor performance of traffic services, there are some things that need to be mentioned here. A service provider is subject sometimes to shocks, such as what is happening in Ukraine. A service provider should be able to absorb the shock, absorb the 30% increase in traffic, for instance. And sometimes we need some spare stuff to be able to cope with such things. Besides, climate change matters. Last year, for traffic controllers in Romania, climate change has an important impact. During the summer of last year, we had something very particular, and that had an impact on the activity. It added to the complexity of our jobs, and that is linked to the capacity of providing services not only under normal circumstances, but also under exceptional circumstances. Perhaps I'm not very clear in my question, but I just come from work this morning at 7. In your materials, you have a feedback template, and please fill it out. It will help us to help the colleagues from the Office of the European Parliament to better target future debates and make the most of future meetings. I am the General Director of the Aerospatial Research Institute. Of course, each profession has a specific point of view of the professions involved. I would like to avail myself of Mr. Marinescu's presence to tackle a few things. Everybody speaks about Sky 1, Sky 2, Cesar 1, Cesar 2. And since Cesar was a negative experience, and since the spearhead is technology, Cesar 2 is the opportunity. What will you do so that in Cesar 2 you can address the real problems we're all faced with, not only Romania, all countries alike? All this activity has already been prepared. But I would like to hear with you what will happen with Cesar 2 in Romania. We have already made some important steps in this direction. We have things linked to the terminals. Yeah, I will try to answer this question Mr. Merrick asked. Frankly, when one asks, one knows part of the answer. He's experienced enough, and he knows that in Romania we haven't changed anything in the fees for the last 10 years. And perhaps we will keep the same levels of the fees even in 10 years from now. Well, there might be a progressive linear raise in the next few years. Of course, these fees are covered from a different source now. But we have other options. We should think about other concepts such as a remote tower. When there is one plane per day, of course, you must consider all these things. Believe me that there are some fees that were frozen 10 years ago, and we can't maintain that. Everything grows by some percentage. That is why we should do something to catch up. I don't know about the raise, whether it will be 2, 3, 5, 7%. So there will be some concrete proposals about the raises in fees. Thank you. Any other interventions on this topic? We still owe answers to the questions asked by Mr. Dinu. We table them at the end. Then we will take another question first. I would like to thank the MEP for his presentation. I would like to add something. I want to speak about Romanza's situation with respect to Cesar. You said we can't fight Cesar. We can't oppose it. And my answer is on the contrary, and let me explain what on the contrary is about. Romanza is now developing three projects under Cesar. One is remote tower, the other one control working position human resources interface, and the third is SWIM. These three projects and their affiliated projects were developed in Romatsa. That is why we would like to integrate this experience inside some bigger European projects. As for Cesar deployment, that will start from October this year. Perhaps you know that we are now undergoing a funding application from INEA. ROMATSA applied with a project, but ROMATSA proposed to have this project integrated. Integrated with the project under CESAR deployment with INEA. 337 proposals were submitted. The procedure will be concluded on the 26th of February. More than 330 proposals were submitted, and two of them got a green light from the very beginning, from their very submission. There is no need of additional information for these two projects. One is was submitted by ROMATSA. It's about a pilot platform with a conveyor for weather data from DMEO to another format. Thank you. You shouldn't be so nervous. This is your child project. That's why you are nervous. I've been working in the field of aviation for 30 years, and I flew two aircrafts for 16 years. So I know very well what I'm talking about. I am head of the SES department in ROMATSA. State Secretary can confirm that, but the member of the parliament really trusts your word. Don't worry. Other questions, perhaps? Good afternoon, I'm Marian-Jean, and I represent the trade union, the trade union from ROMATSA. First of all, allow me to say that we can't agree on blaming air traffic services only for everything that is linked to high cost. Of course, the comparison with the USA is not the best. There is one nation country there, whereas in Europe, history, our long history brought us to a different situation, which creates this natural zigzagging in air routes. Of course, in the field of airspace, we have made a lot of progress lately, from interoperability. That was the first thing we solved in Europe, as the director mentioned before. We're close to finding a permanent solution to that. CESAR contributes to the solution. And most air traffic units or systems have an interface connecting them to the rest of Europe and ensuring high interoperability. That is why sometimes differences in systems can be beneficial. There would be a difference in price, there would be some competition. As long as there is interoperability, why should we have a single system operating throughout Europe? I would like to add something else, too. they say that the ATM sector is responsible for delays. I have several figures. ATM is responsible for 8% of all the delays. That is 54% of all of these delays are to be traced back to airline companies. These are meaningful figures when it comes to improving the efficiency. I think we should look somewhere else and find new ways to reduce costs. Inefficiency in horizontal flight. Well, now inefficiency is 3.14%. Adică 14.7 miles, that is 27.2 kilometers, which is short compared to overall flight distance. And I think airline companies should be aware of the fact that it is not possible to go straight from point A to point B. This is not up to traffic control. It is not up to traffic control to show the straight line between two points. Sometimes airlines choose to fly otherwise. There could be some choices influenced by the weather, influenced by some other decisions at the level of the airlines. And traffic service cost is lower than, much lower than the cost of fuel, for instance. Lately, in 2013, 2014, and this starting year, we have a different situation with airlines companies. The profit for the last few years has gone up a lot. This is undeniable. The cost of fuel represented the core of this profit. Well, this is no complaint, but we want to be constructive. But, you know, safety is somehow left behind. It has not been measured in the last few years. We are starting now to measure it. And we do appreciate that in SES 2+, we have the concept of just culture, which right now in Europe is hardly implemented at all. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We are now very behind. We've overextended, so I'm going to ask our guests to answer the questions we've had so far. Would you like to answer? No, I think we should talk about 552 at the end and to clear up some things. Regulation 216, the draft regulation, takes over some elements from 552, but if the draft for 216 and the draft for SES 2+ are not put into force at the same time, we will have trouble coordinating the two. This is what I wanted to point out. And as for the rest, I can tell you more at the end. The microphone is not on. Yes, this is what I want as well. I want the two to go together. When France had the presidency 5 years ago, they wanted to move forward with one of the regulations and stop the other, but I disagreed. When I said that there are deficiencies in the system, I was actually speaking about the entire system, not just about what is happening in Romania. When we devise a regulation, we have to consider all of Europe, not just Romania. So, dear lady, if you will pay attention, when I said that we cannot fight Cesar, I was speaking about the whole of Europe, not just Romania. It so happens that I am aware of what you are doing in Romatsa and in Romania, because we receive a lot of briefings and I read all the information I get. And you said that you have a good project that was selected. Well, Massimo Gardini, the former director, is a friend of mine, and now he is an executive director of the deployment manager. I believe that Cesar is extremely important, and he is the one to implement Cesar. Unfortunately, he wasn't able to come here, although I would have liked him to come. He has some family problems. But he will be present in future debates. As for the terminal charges, well, there's a lot of discussions about this. I don't know if there are charges for ultralights or for lights. You said that you don't know how to cover your costs. Well, costs will be covered by the charges, by the taxes. I don't know how much this will cost for general aviation, how much is an ultralight. But you know that in Europe there are companies that manage control towers. This is a free sector. Now, about safety, we've talked about it. I've mentioned safety. I didn't mention only money, but also safety, because the focus of the regulation is on safety. I know that this regulation will greatly affect the trade unions. And I know that in 2010, when a declaration was signed in Madrid for SES, I know that France went on strike because they thought that everybody in the industry would agree with the declaration in Madrid. I think they went on strike three times, when Mr. Callas made the announcement, when it was presented in the parliament. I know this will create difficulties or problems, but we have to engage in a dialogue that will allow us to step forward. When you draft legislation, irrespective of the sector or industry, you have to consider all the stakeholders, all the people that will be affected by that regulation. So in our case, this regulation will take into account the airports, the air traffic controllers, the airlines, the passengers, everybody. You can't expect to gain bigger benefits simply because you can go on strike. We don't want to antagonize air traffic controllers, but what we want is to enable the industry to perform better. We haven't even talked about the lack of performance in Romania, but this performance scheme tries to aim the existing performance and bring it to a higher level. The purpose of SES is to increase the safety level by 10 times. This is the aim that was stated in the very beginning. The gentleman is not using the microphone. No, actually, there are no changes. You are from the NSA, right? How many are you? How many are you? Oh, we have 220 employees. No, in the NSA, 40 people, including the support service. So are you separate or together with the authority? No, we are within the same authority. So then why not have a single authority? Why should we have two? The National Aviation Authority, let's call it that. We have a single one. The ministry said that the NSA will operate within the NAA, but in other areas we have three or even four authorities. So actually, in Romania, things are looking good. It's like I want them to be. So I think Romania can be a good example. Now, the clean sky, we can keep talking about it, but it will not change. You have to look at the changes in the activity, not in the administration or organization. Now, what about the clean sky? I am a shadow rapporteur this year, an EPP shadow rapporteur for the discharge for the clean sky and CSR, all the joint undertakings of the EU. And this week, in my committee, I received a question about my focus. Well, I said that my focus would be on value for money, such as what did this program achieve? Were the objectives attained? The authorities can support this. There is a single sky committee that oversees the clean sky and CSR. And in that committee, I know that Romania has representatives, and they should be the one to step in. They should do something. Otherwise, myself in the parliament cannot do anything in this respect. And finally, you said that the US is one country, whereas the EU is a single market. Yes, we are a single market, and I think the two can be compared. We are indeed 28 states, but they are also several states within the same country. We have a single market in Europe, free movement of people, goods, services, and capitals. This is why we created the European Union, to be more efficient and to face up to the competition from the US and China. So we cannot afford to remain fragmented. And then somebody said that aircraft do not fly from point A to point B, but there is a free route. You said that in the US the roads are straighter, whereas we have more curves, but I don't think we can compare this with air traffic. I don't know if you are aware of the true meaning of just culture in aviation. It would mean that me, working in service X, should go to a private operator to say that an incident happened and was not reported. So this is how it works. I want to point out that the Romanian Civil Aeronautic Authority, together with Eurocontrol, held a workshop in 2014 where we brought together prosecutors, civilian and military prosecutors specializing in aviation, and inspectors who specialize in investigating air incidents. And they use the same language to talk to each other, to talk to us. We are strongly committed to this just culture, and we hope to convey this to the guys in Brussels. This is a key element in our aviation. Just a short question with a short answer. It's a question that we received from our online viewers. The question is, what countries oppose this draft regulation and why? Well, the biggest opposition comes from France. Why? Because I was told directly this report, this regulation will destroy the administration. And I replied, yes, but this is about the single sky and the passengers. And they insisted that no, this will destroy the administration. Of course, you know that in France they have a huge administration with lots of benefits and special privileges for fonctionnaires, for the civil servants. And this is why they oppose the regulation. The NSA can be independent, can be in the same framework of civil servants, can be independent legally or functionally. That's what they say in France, but I don't think there should be a distinction. I think independence should be full independence. And there are also other countries that oppose the regulation. If you look at the footnotes, you'll see that there are a lot of objections from Cyprus. If you go to Cyprus and see how they do air traffic control, well, you'll be surprised. And there are footnotes to the council text. We oppose this, we oppose that, we don't want this, we don't want that. When examining a regulation, we have to take into account all the voices in Europe, some at a higher level, some which have a less powerful voice, but we have to take into account all of them. But my invitation stays, if you want to discuss the text, to have a very detailed discussion on the text, we can always do this. Thank you. I'd like to thank everybody and all the stakeholders that are affected by this mechanism, which will bring changes for the administration, but also for the European citizens. Now, I think we're going to close here. Thank you so much for this debate. I hope it brought an added value to you. And I'm going to give now the floor to our host. I just want to say goodbye to you formally. Today we had the privilege to witness a debate with experts from a very elite sector for Romania. Thank you for attending. And in the coming period, our office will continue with the information activities. We will report back to the rapporteur, and with your permission, we will keep you updated with the latest developments in the European Parliament. And with the support of Mr. Marinescu, with his willingness, let's hope that we will be able to keep meeting in this format for further debates. And just one small observation, I hope you have the time to take a short lunch. You're invited to lunch.